What did I say? Yesterday, not yesterday, last week. Vishvam. What did I say Vishvam was?
Vivida Gamyam.
Vivida Pratyaya Gamyam Vishvam. Yeah. Vivida manifold Pratyaya cognition Gamyam, that which comes to be understood through manifold cognition. What is that? Through various cognitions, what is understood?
The Jagat.
That is how such a beautiful definition of the Jagat, centered on that conscious being who is the conscious principle. Consciousness principle. That is what it is. And so, Vividha Pratyaya Gamyam Vishvam. So, Vishvasya, Tat Vishvasya, of that Vishva, what? Of that which is cognized through manifold cognitions, through pratitis, cognitions, karta means the creator. And here Adi Shankara says, sarvasya jagatah, without leaving anything to be desired of the entire jagat, karta utpadayata, the one who has brought this into being, how? Swamayaya, through the mayik, it's a mayik, apparent reality, it is apparent. And the parent of this apparent reality is Brahmaji. That's what it is. This apparent reality. That's why I gave the example of the incense stick. Alata. Alata means incense stick. Yeah. So we have this incense stick, a firebrand, if you will. And with that you can write a name. You can write cat and there is cat. You can draw some whiskers and you can draw two ears. You can draw a wagging tail and say dog. You can draw so many things. You can draw a building. You can draw a family with stick figures. You know, you can draw children, cat, dog, garden, house, everything you can draw. And that is the status of this Jagat. It all resides here. Jagataha upalabdhisthanam. Right between this 10-inch place in the temples. This is the temple of the Jagat, pun intended. The temples where the Jagat is cognized, that the Jagat does not have, to say that the Jagat does not have any more of a reality. So, sarvasya jagataha karta utpadayita. That's why the Upanishad uses the word Vishvam. And then Bhuvanasya, now we are getting more specific, Gopta, the protector of the Bhuvana. Bhuvana here means these various fields of experience, Chaturdasha Bhuvanani, these 14-fold kinds of, you know, various fields of experience. And what are they? They are Atala, Vitala, we saw all that. So these various kinds of lokas, Gopta means the one who protects them, takes care of them, does not let them come into peril and winds them up when it is time also. So the Samharta is also included in Gopta. Just because it only says Gopta, don't think that that's all it is. The Samharakarta, you know, the one who is the Samhartru of the whole Jagat is also included, because that power of creation, sustenance and resolution lies in this one person here, which is this one personage, which is Paramatma, in the form of Lord Brahmaji. So then he says that these words karta and palayita are visheshanam. Visheshanam means what?
Qualifiers.
Yes, adjectives. Visheshana, adjectives. So adjectives to what? Brahmaji. To Lord Brahmaji they are adjectives. And why should I keep praising Brahmaji? Oh, he is the Karta. Oh, he is the Gopta, Palayita. Oh, he is the Samharta also. Oh, he is everything. Why do I have to keep praising Brahmaji? Because in praising Brahmaji, Brahmaji is not going to get flattered and get one more feather in his cap. You know, Brahma cap. You know, because I have praised him. Correct? Bhagavan needs no flattery and Bhagavan is immune to flattery, because that which is everything, what can you say? You cannot say anything that he already doesn't know. Oh, you are Vishvasya Karta, and Lord Brahmaji is going to say, aha, you are, you know, Chaturdasha Bhuvanasya Gopta. Okay, next, You know, that's why Sahasranama, 108 names, 108 names, Laksharchana, 100,008 names you can do safely, because Bhagavan will not have a big ego. And if you don't do it, Bhagavan will not have a bruised ego. Yeah. So that is what it is, because that which is all is not subject to flattery. Is not subject to hyperboles, because how much can you exaggerate the all? That which is infinite, you know, every form of flattery is finite. So that which transcends all flattery, here, then why these two adjectives are given? To show that, you know, Brahmaji is so great. So Brahmaji doesn't need to know he is so great, correct? Does he need to know that? No. Then who needs to know that? The jiva who is studying this, reading this Upanishad needs to know that. The big question is why? You know? Why? Because the human mind is such that unless this knowledge comes highly recommended, I'm not going to sit and listen to it. Yeah. That's what it is. Because if the source is fallible, Brahmaji is kabhi kabhi karta, mostly bhokta. You know, if it was said, Vishvasya karta bhokta cha, you know, then, you know, there is no. And Brahmaji sometimes makes a mistake by creating a few beings, Frankenstein, you know, being one of them. Like this, you know, there is, if it was like that, then the chances of him making a mistake while giving this knowledge also is very high, correct? A fallible Brahmaji in connection to creating this Jagat means a fallible teacher in regard to this knowledge. So here is the shift the Upanishad does in seeing Brahmaji, in delivering its purport of seeing Brahmaji as the Karta and the Gopta, the Palayita, the creator and the sustainer of this universe, and praising Lord Brahmaji by giving these various adjectives is not just vyartha, is not just, you know, for no reason at all. It's not a useless praise. What is it? It is for the sake of praising the knowledge that is going to come out of Brahmaji very soon. So if you praise the person, you give them a veracity, an authenticity, a truth claim to coming out of them, that if such a person who has done this Jagat infallibly, this Jagat is infallibly crafted, regardless of the violence, regardless of planes disappearing and not being found, regardless of all kinds of, you know, miscreants, terrorists, hijackers, you know, your regular neighborhood cut purse, all regardless of all these people, it is all what infallibly. And why do these people exist? To exhaust your karma. That's why they exist. They are exhausting, but they are exhausting your karma. That's what it is. That's why in the Sri Rudram, in the one of the holiest prayers, we say Namaha Naktancharebhya, to all these nocturnal beings who creep and crawl around in the, when all the good people are asleep. Namaha. I transcend their individual personality of violence or their difficult childhood or all the adharmic actions. I transcend that and look at the order of dharma and adharma and my own karma. So if I am, you know, face to face with such a miscreant, you know, that yes, you know, there was some foolishness involved, there was some free will involved on their part, there was free will involved in on my part that put me in this situation, but mostly it is karma, because of my karma. He came to relieve me of my possessions. So you can say this is my karma, you can say it's my bad karma. Most people will say that, you know. That one born again church is there and somebody made off with $500,000 of this new age born again church. And you know, so the leader of the church could say this is our bad karma. In fact, that's what they are saying. This is so sad. We are only doing good things. We are just converting a few people, that's all. And but we are doing mostly good things. And here is, this is what is befalling us. Or if they had the maturity, You know, if they come to me, I will teach them in 1 second how to see it as good karma. Why? Instantly all that money gone means instant vairagya. For free you have got. Yes. And without vairagya, this knowledge will not speak. So if you have been dispossessed, that means you have made space for the knowledge, really. So this whole praising of Bhagavan as the infallible manifester of the universe, that infallibility is being carried over for a different reason. It is doing anuvritti. It is being carried over for an entirely different reason. And he says, Brahma Vidya Stutyarthe. In the sense of praising the Brahma Vidya, the knowledge that is going to come out of this Brahmaji, which is this knowledge? The knowledge about yourself. That is why when you praise this Vidya, and he said that in the earlier, in the Upodghata Bhashya, he said that in this, he said that in the introductory Bhashya itself, that the people are at samsarinaha, anye samsarinaha jayanti, he's already said that. They are all, inside samsara, gulping, coming up for air once in a while, And they are mostly inundated with all the mundane fears and trajectories and all kinds of situations. And then what happens? As a result, they are not available for the knowledge. The ears are plugged up with the water of samsara. Cannot hear anything. That was a new one, yeah. So, they are going like this, they cannot even hear. Even Tattvamasi knowledge is delivered, there is a block caused by the aches and sorrows of samsara. So what to do in such a situation? And go back to the introductory. This is how the whole thing is tied together. Let's go back a little bit and revisit the introduction. You will see where he says that. Not only Shrotra Buddhi Prarochanaya, that is a very good one. Next one. Stutya Prarochitayam hi Vidyayam Sadaraha Pravarteran iti. Because we have to go from this stuti to that stuti. Very good. I am glad you caught that. So, Shrotra Buddhi Prarochanaya. First to inculcate a little bit of, interest in the potential hearer. So first the ear block is removed, by shaking the person like this. Or maybe giving them some chewing gum, you chew gum and then you do like that and then the ear opens up, right? So, Shrotra Buddhi Prarochanaya. In order to make it interesting. And then what? Then he makes the final thing. Stutyahi. Only when this knowledge is praised. When this knowledge, a praised knowledge, Stutya prarochitayam hi vidyayam, absolute locative construction. Only in the condition that the knowledge is totally praised, then only sadaraha adarena saha vartante sadaraha pravarte run. Run means what? They run towards it. How? With shraddha and bhakti pravarte run. Means it's a ling. Ling means in this condition they will go towards it. With the adequate shraddha and bhakti which was already designed earlier. Later he is going to say shraddha bhakti purasaraha. We have seen that. Only when Shraddha and Bhakti are unleashed in front, then only this knowledge will speak. So first the Shraddha and Bhakti has to be created. Without that, the person is not going to listen. Shraddha and Bhakti are the unplugging devices for the ears plugged up by the waters of samsara. And then what? And here, what is the unplugging device? The praise of Lord Brahmaji is indeed the praise of the knowledge. And so there it has a utilitarian purpose, number one. Number two, which is not mentioned, is that when you praise the Brahma Vidya, you cannot but praise the carrier of the knowledge. Why? One is that there is non-separation between the carrier of the knowledge. Between the vakta, the speaker of the knowledge, and then the knowledge itself. And as this very Upanishad is going to reveal later, Brahmavid Brahmaiva Bhavati. The knower of Brahman is Brahman, is not other than Brahman. So therefore, when you praise the Vidya, what are you praising? You are praising the carrier of the Vidya, and vice versa, when you praise the carrier, you are praising the Vidya. He doesn't say that, but you know, we should be able to see this here. So then, and then he says, see how nicely it is tied into the introduction. Such a tight, you know, thing. It's so beautiful. And now I have lost my page. Okay, one more page. There it is. Yeah. So then, sa evam,
sa evam,
prakhyata mahatvah,
prakhyata mahatvah,
brahma,
brahma,
brahma vidyam,
brahma vidyam,
brahmanah,
brahmanah,
paratmanah,
paratmanah,
vidyam,
brahma vidyam,
yenaksharam purusham veda,
yenaksharam purusham veda,
satyam iti,
satyam iti,
visheshanat,
visheshanat,
paramatma visayahi,
paramatma visayahi,
sa,
sa,
brahmana,
brahmana,
va,
va,
agrajena,
agrajena,
ukta iti,
ukta iti,
brahmavidya,
brahmavidya.
Stop there, yeah. So, should have stopped earlier, but doesn't matter. Yeah, should have stopped at iti, but never mind. We'll take it in two installments. Sa evam prakhyata mahatvah. You know, prakhyatvam, prakhyatam, mahatvam, yasya. Classic bahubrihi compound, which describes the person rather than, you know, a thing. So prakhyata means from khya, well known, you know. Prakhyata, known all over the universe. Because where is Bhagavan not known? If you know flower, you know Bhagavan. You know anything that is there is Bhagavan. So that Bhagavan which is ever available, always accessible, never invisible, that is Prakhyata Mahatvam. And also Prakhyata Mahatvam as, you know, six Bhagas. All, having all Aishwarya, all knowledge, all Vairagya, all, you know, Jnanam, all Samarthyam, all these things, omniscient, all these things. Here the Jiva is struggling to spell omniscient, and Bhagavan is the meaning of the word omniscience. So all these ways, the overlordship, etc. So there also Prakhyata Mahatvam, and Prakhyata Mahatvam as Pratibodha Viditam Matam, Prakhyata Mahatvam Eva, meaning that which is available, the truth of which is available in every cognition, in every object, the truth of which is known and is knowable. So evam, so someone whose mahatvam is that famous, is that well known all over, such a brahma, what is he doing here? Evam means in this manner, prakhyata mahatvah, in this manner as what? Vishvasya karta bhuvanasya gopta, described like this. Then brahma vidyam, and he is you know, talking about this compound brahma vidyam, brahmanah vidya, brahma vidya. So this is very interesting, this compound. So in fact, this is just what they call the Shashti Tatpurusha, meaning the sixth case, genitive compound, you know. And what is this genitive compound? Brahmanah vidya, knowledge of Brahman, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's like saying Rahu's head, head of Rahu. What is Rahu? All head, yes? So when you say head of Rahu, what do you mean? You know, it is aupachariki shashti. It is almost like a formal, you know, for the sake of formality, you say head of Rahu. What is the meaning of saying, you know, head of a cabbage when cabbage is all head? People say this. Please buy me one head of cabbage. Cabbage means all head. You know, there is no tail. Nobody says, please buy me tail of cabbage. If that vikalpa was there, then I could say that. But there is no choice here, no vikalpa. So therefore, head means what here? It has no meaning. Because the knowledge of Brahman is Brahman itself. It's not separate from that. So here, so we have to take it in three ways. One is aupachariki shashti. just a kind of a, you know, formality sake you say knowledge of Brahman, but it is in fact the knowledge that is Brahman. The second meaning is you can take it as Karmani Shashti. Karmani Shashti means it's an where the focus is on the object rather than the subject. So the knowledge for which the subject matter is Brahman, Karmani Shashti. Okay. Then you can also, you know, go a step further and say, you know, the knowledge given by Lord Brahma. Brahmana ukta vidya brahma vidya. The knowledge for which the teacher is Brahmaji. So all these meanings are possible grammatically, and all these meanings have to be taken. So first meaning, the knowledge that is indeed Brahman, but here for, because we cannot say that, we are saying knowledge of Brahman, and the knowledge for which the subject matter is Brahman, and then finally the knowledge given by Lord Brahmaji. You see three meanings. It's similar when you say Bhagavad Gita, and then when you make that compound, when you separate that compound into Bhagavataha Gita, Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavataha means sixth case. So you know, the song of the Lord. One meaning, the song for which the subject matter is the Lord. Karmani Shashti, another meaning. So same, in the same manner, we take it in both ways. The song given by the Lord, or the song for which the subject matter is Bhagavan. So like this, we have both the ways. So this Brahma Vidya, and he has something to say about this Brahma Vidya. He says that it is Paramatmanaha Vidya. Very, very, very important. So this knowledge, Brahma Vidya, so if anybody asks, what is this knowledge? It is knowledge of Bhagavan as oneself. That is in one sentence. That is all you have to say. The knowledge of oneself as Bhagavan, or the knowledge of Bhagavan as non-separate from oneself. That's why he used the words Paramatma, because the word Atma is already in there. That Atma, which is manifest as the absolute Karta Palayita of the Vishwa, this Atma is myself alone. That Vidya, Paramatmano Vidya. And then he says, and then he gives a quote from the first Mundaka itself. Yenaksharam Purusham Veda Satyam. And let us look at that, since it is right here with us. Yenaksharam Purusham Veda Satyam. 1, 2 and the third one. One to thirteen. Oh, that's why I was not finding it, because I was finding something else. Okay. No, I felt when I was reading it that there was something wrong here. It cannot be 1, 2, 13. Maybe it is 2, 2, 13.
Oh, Swami,
no,
Upasanna.
Ah, that is one. Tasmai Savidvan Upasannaya Samyak Prasanta Chittaya Shamanvitaya Yenaksharam Purusham Veda Satyam Brahma Vidyam. That's why he quoted it. And this quote is very important, because he says that the Yenaksharam Purusha Veda Satyam, Yena, you know, by which this knowledge is understood, by which the truth of all names and forms is understood. So here he wants to take you straight away to that by which this is understood. We are not focusing on the Upanishad here. We are not focusing on the words of the teacher. What are we focusing on? That which happens when the words are heard. Yena vritti jnanena अखंडाकार वृत्ति ज्ञानेन अक्षरं पुरुषं वेद बाय विच इज अंडरस्टूड व्हाट इज अंडरस्टूड दैट अक्षरा यू नो येन बाय विच इज अंडरस्टूड अक्षरा अक्षरा मीन्स व्हाट न क्षरति या द इम्पेरिशेबल इज अंडरस्टूड येन मीन्स बाय विच नॉलेज सी इट्स नॉट द वर्ड्स ऑफ द टीचर करेक्ट द वर्ड्स कैन कीप ऑन सेइंग वर्ड्स 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 हैमलेट वॉज आस्क्ड यू नो बाय दे वर डूइंग अ टेस्ट ऑन हिम बिकॉज ही वॉज एक्टिंग फनी एंड यू नो ही वॉज सेइंग ऑल दीज मोनोलॉग्स एंड सो हैमलेट वॉज आस्क्ड बाय अ ट्रस्टेड मिनिस्टर पोलोनियस व्हाट डू यू रीड एंड व्हाट डिड ही से words 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 and Polonius came and repeated to the king he's mad no doubt but there is a method to his madness because he is reading words but what is he reading he's not understanding anything so same thing with the upanishad is even though we put a lot of weightage on shabda pramana everything is shabda pramana itself it is communicated through words but then you try to catch hold of the words what will happen you know one word satyam oh I want to hold on to satyam from tree hagar I have become satyam hagar you know and then I'm hold on to jnanam and then I'm holding on to the last one anantam I want to hold on anantali to anantam infinitely to anantam Then किम भवेत what will happen क्या होगा words 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 it's like catching the wind you catch the wind and you say I have caught this wind in this pot there is a hole there oh okay I'm you know closing off both the ends I have caught the air okay sit like this how long you're going to sit really you know so therefore the words even though we say words 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 and this is going to be revealed by this upanishad itself the even the words of the upanishad are what is called shabda rashihi rashi means a huge random heap like leaves you know in fall you see everybody you know rakes the leaves and then puts it in a heap waits for the city to come and take it correct So this heap of leaves. So the words, all the words of the Upanishad. Om Brahma Devanam Prathamas Sambhuva one heap. Vishvasya Karta Bhuvanasya Gopta another small mound heap, and then the two are put together. Sab Brahma Vidyam Sarva Vidya Pratishtham Atharva Yajyeshta Putraya Prah heap 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 heap. Or did you understand? If you collect that and bring it to your house, is anything going to happen? Nothing. So supposing somebody says and somebody said to me I have a whole bookshelf from a 10 foot ceiling to the 0 foot ground I have full of Upanishads it's like having the heap of dead leaves correct no use and even attending lectures and just trying to catch the words some people do that they collect words they collect samasas they are samasa collectors they are little more refined than samosa collectors but nonetheless in the same boat you are a collector of upanishads you are a collector of teachers you are a collector of you know words you are a collector of what is that lectures but here this is not about collecting This is about letting the words operate upon you. It's a surgical procedure. Yeah. Because the words carry the weight of what is said because the person who is saying it is understanding what is being said and that same understanding which was received through the parampara is going to be transmitted. In this moment it is being transmitted. So when the words have an effect is when that transmission is successful and the transmission is never successful unless it is received it has to be received And so that's why I always say that the knowledge is not one aha moment. First it is swaha, swaha, swaha of the words, and then it is a series of aha moments. So when you see in class, in the process of the class, you say, oh, I never thought of that like that. Oh, yes, I think I have it. I got it. And outside of class, somebody asks, what did you learn? Well, you become very diplomatic. I think you should attend for yourself. Because you're not able to reproduce it, because, but that doesn't mean you didn't understand it. This is something we have to understand. Because to be able to reproduce it, you need repeated shravanam. But to be able to, and sometimes even in one class, that understanding takes place. Why? Because that is non-separate from you. It's you we are talking of. We are not talking of something other coming in your head. Or somebody putting a whole lot of lies in your head, drilling through here and saying, oh, you are wonderful, you are great, you are infinite, you are satyam, jnanam, anantam, go away. No, this is not what it is this about. It's revealing something that already is. So it's more of an uncovering rather than putting in new knowledge. So you are already mukta, you already have moksha, you already have this knowledge. You are already infinite. The knowledge is inhibited by doubts, vagueness, error, and a whole host of fears, resistances, and all kinds of nonsense. And the nonsense is slowly, the curtains of this nonsense are removed, revealing the stage. Mm-hmm. In fact, revealing the world as a stage. Mm. And you see all the other actors, you see yourself also, and you laugh. This is what it is. And so by what does this transmission takes place? Now I have stopped calling it teaching. It's more of a transmission. By what means is this transmission taking place? Yes, it is generated by the words, but that is where the teaching starts. It doesn't stop there. Because it's the generated words of the Upanishad, Guru Mukhat, through the mouth of the teacher. And then what? It has to transfer to the ear of the student. That's why it's called Karna Parampara. It transfers through the ear of the student and does not boomerang, does not go and bounce back. And therefore the knowledge is safe with the guru. No, it does not boomerang. Why? Because it's the nature of the student, the shishya, that is being revealed. And if the nature of the shishya is being revealed, that nature is eminently beautiful to hear. If supposing the knowledge was, you are an idiot, you are a sinner, you are full of complexes, you know, who will go? Unfortunately, a lot of people do, but, you know, who? But really nobody likes to go. If someone goes, it is out of a habitual pattern. But if the teaching is saying, you are wonderful, you are great, you are so complete that you don't need anything else. And in fact, you cannot make a mistake. You are free of hurt. You are free of guilt. You are free of papa. You are free of punya. You are free of karma. You are free of dharma. You are that which is Paramatma. You are Bhagavan. Who won't like to hear this knowledge? Tell me. If somebody raises their hand, you know, then what? Then that means that there is a lot of, you know, the non-understanding about what this Brahma Vidya is about. Yena vritya, yena yaya vritya, yena it is said here, but actually it should be yaya. Yaya akhandakara vritya, brahma jnana takes place. So that knowledge takes place means what? It's already in place, but it is taking on a form in the form of understood words, not regurgitated words, not words in a book. Not words which are just heard and not understood, but understood words. And what is that understanding? As myself. Yes. That's why it's called akhandakara vritti. Non-separate understanding. Non-separate from myself. So that vritti is generated in the process of the teaching. And it is of course generated in the form of words. Not mauna vyakhya. You know. And So therefore, the words themselves don't have any weightage, unless they are understood. That is why this one thing we were never afraid of, you know, which other indigenous cultures have always been afraid of. And what have they been afraid of? Oh, our knowledge has been taken away, our lifestyle has been taken away, our customs and cultures have just been decimated by colonization, by all these, you know, different religious traditions coming. We have never been worried about that. We think that's a joke, you know. Now, because if you want to kill off Hinduism, you have to kill off each person that says, I'm a Hindu. And you cannot. You cannot kill every parent, because the parent is what is teaching the child. Maybe they don't know everything, but it is, goes through osmosis. So as long as even one person is there who says, I'm a Hindu, you cannot make this knowledge go away. And so therefore what? Therefore this knowledge is that which is really the truth of oneself. And that truth of oneself, which has this prescribed lifestyle, etc., that is the lifestyle and the vision come together. And the vision of the Upanishad is useless unless it is talked of by the teacher and assimilated by the student. Those two things are very important. And that's why his quotation is not any other quotation. That's why I said we have to look it up. And the reason I looked it up is because it is where the Guru is talking. Yenaksharam Purusham Veda Satyam. So Tasmai Sa Vidvan. That Vidvan, that scholar, that teacher. Upasannaya Samyak. Those two unto whom people come with the proper bhakti and shraddha. Samyak Upasannaya. Prashanta Chittaya. For the someone who has chittam, which is prashanta, a calm mind. Who? The teacher or the student here? Student. You know? And then shamanvitaya, endowed with shama, etc. For such a person, definitely the teacher will teach, and definitely the taught words will become heard words, will become understood words, and then will become assimilated words in that order. That's why he's showing that, to show the centrality of a transmitter of knowledge in this knowledge. And who is the transmitter here?
Brahma.
Lord Brahmaji is alone the transmitter of this knowledge. This Upanishad is beautiful. This is really the best, one of the best Upanishads. I was going to say the best, but then I say that for everything. So, you know, I have stopped now. Yeah. So, yena aksharam purusha veda satyam. So, you see, when Adi Shankara quotes, we have to take it very seriously, because from where he quotes, everything is just a tied, beautiful, you know, wonderful thing. So, iti visheshanat paramatma vishaya hi sa brahmana. Agrajena ukta brahma vidya. So he says these kinds of visheshanas means these kinds of qualifiers, paramatma vishaya hi means this is all just connected to the Lord alone. This subject matter of which is the Lord, and who is this Lord? I, that God who I thought was odd, is me, myself alone. And there are some people who say God is odd, some people who say I am not God, so I am odd. So either way, you know, you understand that there is a complete pravilapanam. Pravilapanam means a complete resolution of that otherness. And whether that otherness is from outside, being experienced as a thorn on the side, or whether that otherness is on the inside and is being experienced as a thorn on the inside, that thorn removal is called Brahma Vidya. And therefore he is the centrality of the teacher in this teaching, and the centrality of the parampara he's already started to discuss. It is fantastic. It is just fantastic. And then he says, then Brahmanava Ukta, and then the second meaning he gives, Brahmanava Agrajena Ukta. Agraja means that which was born before everything else, that which came, not born here, came into being. So the infallible Lord Brahma alone has given the Vidya. I have already explained this, the two meanings of the Shashti, the sixth case, correct? I have already explained this, so no problem. So this is the second meaning. Brahmanava agrajena ukta vidya brahma vidya iti tam, and then back to the Upanishad. Tam sarva vidya pratishtham
sarva vidya
abhivyakti hetutvat. Okay, that was a mouthful. Abhivyakti hetutvat sarva vidya shrayam ityarthah. Yeah, so here he brahma vidya is described by another qualifier, a visheshana, an adjective. What is that? Sarva vidya pratishtha. Pratishtha means the foundation. Sarva vidya, of all knowledge. These are not Shankara's words. These are words from the Upanishad. How do we know? Sabrahma vidyam sarva vidya pratishtham. Atharvaya jyeshtha putraya praha. So he is taking up the word sarva vidya pratishtham from the Upanishad. Sarva vidya, all knowledge, pratishtha. What is pratishtha? Foundation. The adhishthana of all knowledge. And here I'm just going to tell you in advance what he does, and so the reading will be very easy. So two meanings again. With Adi Shankara, there is never one meaning. It's always multiple meanings, you know. You have to keep looking deep, deep, deep until you start looking at yourself. That's what he wants. And so sarva vidya pratishtham, two meanings at least. The first meaning is that which is the foundation of all knowledge, meaning that every vidya is studied. You know, first you have what? Kindergarten vidya. First, who is my mummy, daddy vidya? And then who are my brother, sister vidya? These are all small vidyas. You know, how to tie shoelaces vidya. And then kindergarten vidya, first grade vidya, civics vidya, geography, history vidya, mystery vidya, and all these vidyas are for the sake of what? For the sake of gaining the preparedness for this vidya, correct? Say yes, come on.
Yes.
Exactly. So, so all the vidyas have offered themselves for which vidya? For gaining the preparedness for which vidya? Because without that vidya, this vidya is useless. And also adhikari vidya, how to become an adhikari, knowledge, everything is included, right?
Yes.
So all these vidyas come together here, and that is what is called sarva vidya pratishtham. So when somebody is busy, you know, you see people in the world, and what are they doing? Something or the other. They keep going here, going there, doing this, doing that, picking up this and dropping off that, and then buying this and selling that. Whole world, the internet is full of buyers and sellers. Yes. All kinds of things. eBay and, you know, this bay and that bay and all these things, all buying, selling. And this is the world of transactions. And then for such a person who is busy in such transactions, you say, come, I have a very big secret to tell you. And this is a wonderful secret and you will love this. What will they say? I have no time. I have no time, I'm really busy. Don't bother me, I'm really busy. And then you say, okay, and go away. And then what happens? Then the business fails. The .com folds up. And then, you know, and there is a big dot in their life in the sense of a full stop, meaning nothing is working. No more commas, only exclamation points. How did this happen? Why? Why me? So this why me? You know, leads one to bhai me, and you know, that is the grammar. So then why me, why me, why this happened to me? And then they search for answers everywhere. First they ask the neighbor. Neighbor says the same thing they said to the neighbor 3 months ago. I have no time, don't bother me. And then they go to the psychiatrist. Why me? And the psychiatrist says it's all because of your rotten parents. And then, you know, nobody wants to hear that their parents are rotten. And so from there also they come. Because they have not got the full thing. The psychologist is only able to probe the psychological order a little bit. Yes, they are able to say, okay, everything is coming from your parents. In, with such parents, that you are breathing and walking is a big achievement. And then you have this misguided sense of being praised, but you don't know what to do with that. And then what? And then the person knocks on every door and all of them are shut tight. And you know, and they say when, you know, all the windows are also shut. But they say when God closes a window, opens a door, you know. And that door is what? That door leads to the kutia of the teacher, you know. Mud house door of the teacher, somewhere in the forest. And he didn't want to go for the knowledge. He just said, you know, somebody to talk to he wanted, that's all. He really was not interested. This .com was not interested in the knowledge. The business folded up, everything folded up, life folded up, wife folded up and went along with the children. Everything folded up. So out of a sense of despair, he arrives at the gates of the Guru by accident. And what is this accident? Purva Punya. That's all. It's not an accident. We say accident. But it's just a carefully crafted incident by the aforementioned Prakhyata Mahatvam, Lord Brahmaji. So because of this incident, he comes. And then he sits in front of the Guru and then says, oh, I've had a terrible life, you know. And, you know, this is all these things that happened. What is the meaning of this life? Hey, Guru, please tell me. And finally it dawns that perhaps I should just ask for what is this, why is this happening? So usually this is a last resort, right? But before this man, you know, here in this example, came to this Brahma Vidya, what was this fellow doing? You know, getting .com Vidya, getting how to sell nonsense Vidya, getting how to buy nonsense Vidya, getting how to be ahead of the competitors Vidya. So all this knowledge, see, we have a wonderful way of saying that nothing you learn goes to waste. Yeah, nothing you learn goes to waste. And then what happens? Because it is all for this, for the sake of this knowledge alone, every other knowledge exists because it is for the sake of preparation. And so that is why it is called Sarva Vidya Pratishtham. But then you have to go deeper still. And then how to go deeper still, let us just pick up a flower for that. Okay? Yeah. So when you say flower, correct? Flower Vidya, knowledge of flower. So knowledge of flower has to do with a careful looking. Careful looking means I look at it very deeply until the eyes cross over, and that's what happens when you look like this. So then what happens? Then you look at the color, then you try to mimic the same shade, and then you look at this and everything. And then suddenly when you're looking closely at the flower, what you see is yourself. When you look at the flower, this flower stops becoming a flower and becomes a mirror. How? Because when you see that there is something common between you and the flower, you know, granted you are not fragrant, but still there is something, you know, the flower alone has the fragrance, and even if you want fragrance, you have to put it in a bottle and spray it all over yourself, granted. But still, when you look at the flower, something happens when you look at it very, very deeply, because the truth of you and the truth of the flower happens to be one. And a sukshma buddhi looking at the flower is really looking at Bhagavan, is really looking at yourself alone. That's why sukshma buddhi is needed. A finely, you know, sharpened buddhi is needed. And how do you do that? Because when you say flower, what is flower? But the flower that is here is first manifest here. Correct? In the form of what? Flower vritti. In English, flower thought. I thought of flower. So flower, even before I show the flower, this flower manifested here. Flower thought. And then that flower thought saw this flower which is there and then said, aha, flower. See, I told you, flower. Correct? And here it's almost like a pantomime. It is so fantastic. It's like a Prakriti pantomime where you are really talking to yourself. Because in the flower cognition, there are two things that are going on. One is the cognition of the object, and the object can shift from flower to what is this? Pot to what is this?
Flower pot.
Flower pot. Yeah. So the cognition can go constantly shift, right? So the object of cognition constantly is shifting. But there is one thing that it is based on. The shiftless person, even if you say I am very shifty, you know, there is something that is non-shifting in every cognition. And what is that non-shifting thing in every cognition? What is common in the cognition of flower, in the cognition of pot, in the cognition of flower pot? Kim asti tat? The subject. The object keeps changing. The object is subject to changing, but the subject is not subject to changing. So whenever you see the object, it is predicated upon the non-changing subject, which is aham, aham, aham iti sakshat, sakshi vrittena bhasate. You know, we heard somewhere a long time ago, do not say Bhagavad Gita, before you subject me to that, I will say it is Viveka Chudamani. Yes, so sakshi rupena bhasate. That which is, you know, because in Viveka Chudamani we have a very, very beautiful scenario where the panicked student returns to the teacher saying that the teaching is not working because the teacher told the student to remove all the names and forms and to look at what remains. And the student got panicked because he said, I tried to remove all the names and forms just like you had asked me to, but nothing remains. Nasti kinchana, nothing remains. And then the teacher smiles, has the grace to not make fun of the student, you know. And the teacher says, asti kaschit, look deeper, asti kaschit, swayam, you know, swayam means what? Just like Lord Brahmaji, svatantrena babhuva. The one that is by itself, without needing a mother and father, that which is there, that consciousness which is there without being crafted by or created, that uncreated I, that alone is asti kaschit svayam nityam. There is something which is svayam, which is by itself, nityam, which is there all the time. And then how do I know it? Because it is aham pratyaya lambanaha asti kaschit svayam nityam aham pratyaya lambanaha avasthatraya sakshi san panchakosha vilakshanaha. That which is the witness of all the three states, the teacher says. And that which is separate from these places where you normally make the error of I is equal to body, I is equal to karta, I is equal to mind, I is equal to nonsensical thoughts. You know, this is a mistake. So there is something other that stands apart from all this, unaffected by all this. There is something svayam nityam centered on this I alone. That's how you know it, because it is centered on you. It is you. And so, who is the Sarva Vidya Pratishtha?
I.
Abba. It came late, but the answer came. Thank God. These are the times the Vedanta teacher becomes very happy. So, asti kaschit svayam nityam aham pratyaya alambanaha. And it is based on this I alone. And then later on the teacher says, aham aham iti sakshat. Sakshi rupena bhasate. How to find it? Always say the witness. Connect to that witness, and that witness alone is. So that witness is this Sarva Vidya Pratishtham. Did you understand both the meanings?
Mm-hmm.
What is the first meaning? Review time.
First meaning is the knower of all small things.
What is that? First meaning. Sarva Vidya Pratishtham. First meaning, please.
Knowing all
two meanings were discussed.
Foundation.
Yeah, means what? Yeah, Sarvavidya Pratishtha means foundation. The word foundation of all knowledge has two meanings. What is the first meaning? What is the second meaning?
The first meaning is the foundation of all knowledge, that which prepares.
For which all knowledge, all other fields of knowledge exist. Sarvavidya Pratishtha, in order to give one the qualification to study this knowledge. And then the second meaning?
All knowledge
is in the form of that knowledge which transcends the cognizer and the cognition and is centered on the subject alone, because of which Chaitanya Atma, everything becomes clear, because of which consciousness the subject exists, because of which consciousness the object exists, and because of which consciousness they come into a certain relationship called the knower-knower relationship, knower-known relationship. That consciousness is the foundation of all knowledge, including the knower and the known, and that vidya, sarva vidya pratishtham. And then he gives the examples. First meaning, he says that sarva vidya abhivyakti hetutvat, because of which everything becomes evident. You know, that this is the, our second meaning is his first meaning. So, sarva vidya ashrayam ityarthah. Then he says, va, optionally, sarva vidya vedyam vastutva anaya eva vijnayate iti. Vastu anaya eva vijnayate. So, anaya vidyaya eva sarvani vastuni vijnayante. So, by which all things come to be known, because of this alone. Because see, this is something which is wonderful, because in every other branch of knowledge, this is our first meaning that we gave, in every other branch of knowledge, the more you know, the less you know. You know? Because you take simple botany, you know, you say flower, why is this like this? Don't know. Why it is bent here? Don't know. Why this inside petal have different color than outside petal? Don't know. Why there is inside petal? Don't know. Why it's different from yellow rose? Don't know. Why this comes in different colors? Don't know. Why this flower is small and this flower is enormous? Don't know. See, the more you know, the more you don't know. And don't think, okay, I'm not a botanist. And maybe if you go to an expert, the expert also is just one more question away from, I do not know. Just go a little deeper. We do not know. And all you need, you don't need to go to a botanist. Go to a doctor. Why is this happening to me, doctor? This is a multi-specialty, you know, and all the letters of the alphabet have found place behind his name. You know, highly qualified. Yeah, MD, you know, MBB, this FRCS and all these things, everything from A to Z is behind his name. You don't have to look for the alphabet in the kindergarten book. You just look behind his name, all the alphabets are there with little strange full stops in between. And then you ask the person, why is this happening to me, doctor? What do I have? Well, he won't say, I don't know, because, you know, then how to bill you for that afterwards. So, we are still looking into it. Yes, you can become part of an experimental drug. You know, it has of course caused huge tumors in rats, but we don't know what it will do to you. We can say that. Or he will say, what will they say? They will say things like, oh, you know, this is a syndrome. We find that only people, you know, who are between the ages of 20 to 50, that could be anybody, correct? Yeah, can get this. Men rather than women tend to get this. But then I'm a woman, doctor, how did I get this? Well, there is always exceptions. And this is how it is. And we know the symptoms. You're feeling, you know, you're feeling this, right? Yes. And then, yes, that's normal because of this syndrome. They never call it a disease. It's always a syndrome. And what is a syndrome? A syndrome is a collection of unexplained and unexplainable symptoms. That's why it's called syndrome. That's what it is. That's all it is. So therefore, even the doctor doesn't know. We'll try this for 15 days and then we'll switch over to you to this new drug protocol, which means what? If after 15 days it doesn't work and our original hypothesis was wrong, then you can go on the next set of other drugs whose side effects are yet to be researched. You know, every knowledge is you don't know. That's why the people start keeping studying. There was one person called Bhatnagar, you know. And in this country, if somebody has the name Bhatnagar, how will they say it? Bhatnagar with an American accent, how will you say it?
Bhatnagar.
And the person studied bats. Really honest. Person's whole life was given to bats. You know? How they communicate, what they eat, why they hang upside down, everything. But you ask the person any question, after which they will bat you around for the answers because they don't know. You know? They don't know. And that's why this drive to be one with Ishvara sometimes makes one into a, you know, academic. Really. Because the drive to be with Ishvara is so strong, I think that somewhere there is this knowledge, and one is right, knowledge is Ishvara. But then I confuse the knowledge of forms to that which it upholds. I don't know that Adhishthana, and in trying to get to the Adhishthana, I'm skimming the surface of all knowledges, and I become a knowing hound. I just keep going after degrees and degrees and degrees and degrees. And my knowledge is really 0 degree, really. Because all knowledge, that the truth of that, I'm not able to touch through academia. That's why I call it academentia, you know. So this is what it is. You know, academia only makes me skim. And the person becomes obsessed. I have to find out. And then reads books and does experiments and does all these things and gets a little piece and has an aha moment. And then somebody else publishes another book on that very thing. Oh, everything gone. Now I have to study more. I have to do this more. I have to get this. All this is the hunger of Ishvara. And where is this Ishvara? Right here. Sarva Vidya Pratishtham. There is where Ishvari is. There is where Ishvara is. And instead of looking here, one is going everywhere. This is what it is. So, you know, by which everything else as well becomes known. Because see, this vidya is different. Because if I say I want this knowledge, then if you choose this knowledge, knowing which everything becomes known, because this is the truth of everything. Yaya aksharam adhigamyate and yaya sarvam api adhigamyate, because this is the knowledge of everything. So in all knowledge there is the variable and the invariable. I know the variable, I'm always varying, I'm always in search of the variable, but I know the invariable as myself, then I as well know everything. That's why he gives a very fantastic quote. Yena ashrutam shrutam bhavati. Read that.
Yena
ashrutam bhavati
amatam matam
avijnatam iti shrutehe. Yeah, he quotes the Chandogya Shruti, which is the sixth chapter of the Chandogya Upanishad. He says, yena, by which the unheard becomes heard, the unknown becomes known, the unseen becomes seen. And you know, this is what it is. So this means what? That all sight is at the, you know, is the all sight is what? Is for the sake of what? All sight emerges from that source, which is neither the seer nor the seen, but that consciousness alone, because of which everything is known. Because of which flower is known, pot is known, flower pot is known. Same thing, we have discussed this, you know, we have already seen this. Our second meaning here is talked about here very beautifully. You know, whatever we discussed is also here. And so he talks about it with a very beautiful and appropriate quote. Iti shrutehe. And then he says, सर्वविद्या
सर्वविद्या
प्रतिष्ठामिति च
प्रतिष्ठामिति च
स्तौति
स्तौति
सो विद्यां स्तौति एंड विद्यां इज देयर इन योर बुक इन माय बुक इट इज नॉट देयर बट इट डजंट मैटर सो इट इज इवन इफ इट्स नॉट देयर इट इज अंडरस्टूड सो विद्यां स्तौति विद्यां इज द ऑब्जेक्ट ऑफ स्तौति व्हाट इज दिस स्तौति यू नो प्रेजेस one of those you know second conjugation verbs which have a rule for everything and what is that stu nu and ru take vriddhi before the tip before the ti so stauti stu becomes stau because of not guna vriddhi a little trivia yeah second conjugation grammars and script trivia and not trivial however so so trivia and so stauti praises what does he praise vidyam stauti praises the knowledge why because we already saw in the introductory bhashya stutyahi vidyam you know stutyahi prarochitayam hi vidyayam sarve mumukshavah pravarte run so all the mumukshus run that's why it's used pravarte run they run towards this vidya only when its glories are emphasized because if you don't know the glory you know you don't come to class even if you know the glory you don't come to class so that means imagine if you don't know the glory how much more your attendance will be affected if you did not know the glory so the glory of the vidya is praised in the beginning so much so that the person has no other option but to just follow this and the glory is not exaggerated because you cannot exaggerate the infinite you can only exaggerate the finite you cannot exaggerate the infinite so sarva vidya pratishthamiti cha stauti so first there was the stuti of the guru because it's coming from a credible source look at where all the praises are lying so first to praise was what he used the word stuti sutyartham he said where yeah not sutyartham stutaye visheshanam brahmanah stutaye so in order to praise bhagavan as the teacher so that you know that this knowledge has originated from an infallible source the first praise was there correct yeah and then the second praise is that of what the student no the knowledge itself when the knowledge is praised and why is the knowledge praised for the same reason that the teacher is praised because if you don't have the credentials of the teacher as infallible and if you don't have the credentials of the teacher if the teacher is not glorified as the lord himself nobody will have any credibility left for this vidya and then so to make the vidya attractive and credible this is coming from bhagavan that's why it's called bhagavad gita it's coming from the lord then you say oh then I will listen because if you say it's coming from your tata nobody wants to listen you know yeah some tata somewhere sitting on a tree said this nobody is going to listen yeah and so that to get that credibility you know you have that immaculateness of that knowledge in every tradition we find it even the words of the prophet you know it is the latest and the last meaning there will not be any other prophet it's not going to be contradicted by some other prophet so these kinds of things we see in any revealed knowledge you know so that immaculateness of the knowledge is there so that one will take to it seriously and then what and then he says that you know sarva vidya pratishtham to say that if you know this you know everything number 1 and this alone is for the sake of all your knowledge is for this sake alone both those things so vidyam cha stauti and then what
atharvaya
jyeshthaputraya
prah
jyeshthascha asau
putrascha
anekeshu brahmanah
srishti prakareshu
let us stop here because there is plenty to talk about so अथर्वाय ज्येष्ठपुत्राय प्राह. सो दिस विद्या, व्हाट डिड ही डू, यू नो व्हाट डिड ही डू विथ दिस नॉलेज? या प्राह, प्राह प्रकर्षेण आह, आह आहतुः आहुः, यू नो लिट. व्हाट इज लिट? Yeah, that should light up. Lit. Lit means perfect tense. Long ago. Parokshe. In long ago, ahuhu. Long ago told. Aha here, singular. So, prakarshena aha means told until it was understood. Taught the knowledge, not just taught once and went away. Until Atharva said, enough, enough, I now understand. Alam, enough. I understood now. And until Atharva himself got up and went away, Brahmaji taught completely. So, prakarshena aha, praha. And what did he praha? He didn't give him a lecture. I think you should go clean your room. You know, I think you're being very insolent. You know, when is this teenage going to be over? And all these things he didn't say. Neither did he tell him his own burdens. I'm growing old. How will I die? I have all these worries. Should I give you my property or should I? Property means jagat. So should I? Should I give you or should I give the other son? He didn't say that. What did he talk about? Brahma vidyam praha. He taught the only thing there is to teach, the only thing there is to talk about, the only thing that is worth talking about. That only he taught fully. And what is asserted here is jeshthascha asau putrascha. So he was the son and he was the eldest son. And herein lies a beautiful thing. Because the eldest son gets the choice legacy from the parent. Especially in a patriarchal culture. Everything is reserved for the sake of the eldest son. Not the middle son, the youngest, etc. Those are all, you know, later. The eldest son is where, you know, the parents are also raising the eldest son, because the eldest child is a surprise, you know, they don't know. It doesn't come with a booklet of instructions. What to do when it malfunctions, you don't know. And there is no troubleshooting. Yeah. There's only trouble. That's all. There is no troubleshooting. If it cries, I mean, has, you know, you have to kind of think, okay, a nappy has been changed, feeding has taken place, so therefore colic. You have to think of it like that. You have to use what is called parishesha nyaya, the logic of residues in raising the first child. And the first child, you know, learning to walk, falls down, oh poor thing, let me carry you for the rest of my life. This kind of protective feelings the parents have. Second child, third child, the third child is screaming and rolling on the floor. You know, the parents say, get over it, come on. We know, how long are you going to hold your breath? You will cry eventually and you will console yourself, no problem. Because they have seen it all, correct? But the first child, they are very cautious, they want the best school. The third child will go to just the neighborhood, you know, some person has put a board in front of the house, S-K-O-O-L, yeah, go there. Go, doesn't matter, nothing will happen. They have the confidence, having raised the other earlier children, that nothing will happen. But the first child, there is no confidence, so everything is done with so much protection, so much love. Oh, don't fall down. Oh, what happened? Oh, you have fever. Never mind that it's only 99, but still it's a fever. Why do you have fever? Oh, did I give too much Tylenol? Oh, some new study has come. Tylenol must not be given. Oh, what have I done? So I'll keep vigil whole night like this. You know, the first child evokes a lot of love and protectiveness. And so that's why it is said, to the first child has gone this lion's share of the property. And here what? A lion itself has been given, because it is Sarva Vidya Pratishthan. What a legacy to give to the first child. And then he says, Jeshta Putraya. So, and also, that is the first meaning, Jeshta Putra. And also, when you are giving something to your child, that to a first child, you will not give something that misleads, correct? You will not send the child on a red herring, you know, some kind of a wrong scent. You will not give them a knowledge that is suspect, You will not give them a knowledge that will make them do wrong things or believe wrong things about themselves. Because you are convinced that this is the only thing to give, and you give it completely without holding anything back. You know, sometimes in these other teachers, cooking teacher, dance teacher, they're always afraid of a little competition. What if the student excels the teacher? Then where will I go? Then the Google will be filled with my student's name rather than my name. And so how to stop that? The cooking guru has a very nice formula that they have cooked up. They will tell everything except the main thing that is to be done.
Secret ingredient.
Secret ingredient, you got it. That's how all the restaurants run in this country. There's always some secret ingredient. Yeah, like yum sauce, you know. Yeah, there's one secret ingredient. The yum is a big thing. Have you had yum? Ah, we should get them yum. Yeah, today maybe we'll take them there. So this yum is a thing of Eugene. Yeah, yum is a lakshana of Eugene. Very wonderful thing. Yeah, and nobody knows how to make the sauce except these yummy people in the yum shop. And you know, and what about this sauce? You know, you can make it at home, but then you don't know the secret ingredient, correct? Oh. So like this, they may teach you how to make it. They may have a yum sauce class, but they will leave out the secret ingredient. Why? Because they want us to take all the visitors to the yum shop. So this is what it is. So they will not tell. And likewise, the cooking guru will not tell. They will leave the main instruction out, that when you are adding these things, it should be stirred continuously. So you just add without stirring, and then the pot, the pot has an experience of non-separateness from what was put in it. The pot gets Advaita from all the things that was put in it. It becomes one, so much so that you have to throw away the pot. Why a main thing was left out? What was left out? Stir constantly, or stir over a non-existent flame. You know, that also is very important. Stir over a low, slightly flickering flame. And if you don't tell that, and the person has the gas on medium or high, then finished. Then you have an experience of cooking Advaita. Yes, and because everything becomes one with the pot, and then the pot itself has to be given up. And so like this, every teacher holds something back because they don't want the student to be greater than themselves. In fact, this is papa karma. It is said that if you do that, what will happen? Huh? After death, such a teacher becomes a Brahma Rakshasa. Yes, sits on a tree because that unsaid thing is still there, weighing on the conscience. And that pressure to teach hasn't gone. Sits on a tree in a disembodied form. And anyone who comes and goes catches hold of them and starts to teach. And the same thing happens to a person who is capable of teaching this knowledge, Brahma Vidya, who has studied, who is capable. If you have studied and not capable of it, please don't teach. But if you have studied and you are capable of it and you don't teach, the belief is that you'll again have a tree perch when after leaving the body, and then every bystander, everybody who comes and is hapless enough to sit under a tree, you start teaching them Om Brahma Devanam Prathamas Sambhavad. You start teaching them. So therefore, you have to give, you know, this knowledge. And there's only one way to give this knowledge, because it's the knowledge of all. It is entirely given, because that you which is being talked about is complete, infinite, limitless, total, and above all, free of parts, impartite. So you cannot say, I'm going to give you a half of Brahman today, and then the second half I'm reserving for tomorrow, because otherwise what will I talk about? You cannot say that. In each class, in each situation, the entire thing is given. And that itself is an art. And that teaching you learn from your teacher. That's how it is. And this art alone is wonderful. And so this is here. What is that? Jeshtha Putra. Just by bringing in that compound, the Upanishad says that here he was given the choicest of knowledge, the best of knowledge. And how was it given? Completely, because there is nothing to hold back. I will only give A for Atma, you know, T for Turiya tomorrow. No, you cannot do that. You cannot do that. That Atma is Turiya, is the one that upholds all the other states, is the one without which nothing else is there. That is the foundation of everything. So this is the only knowledge that cannot be given after holding something back. So therefore, in that sense, now he is praising the parampara as well. So first we are going into that tomorrow. First we had the stuti of the teacher, then we had the stuti of what? The knowledge. Now the stuti of the lineage is going to start, and then it's going to extend into verses 2 and 3 as well. We will see that when? Tomorrow. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om. I have a question for a change. Are we going too fast? Is this speed okay? Yeah, the speed is comfortable. Okay, good. Just check it. So now I can take your questions if you have any, online, offline, etc. Very nice to see all of you online. I'm so happy. Very good. Yeah, this time slot seems to be very popular, huh? Yeah, because for East Coast it is good. Good, keep enjoying. That is the idea. Yes, welcome back, Judy. Glad you are back. Any questions here?
No question, but a comment.
Sure.
One becoming a Brahma Rakshasa, I'm sitting on a tree. Is that the basis of this Vedala Panchavimshati, you know, this Vedala
Panchavimshati, yeah, yeah. That's the Chanda Mama, yeah, yeah, that is what it is. For children, we have a story book, a long-term story book called Chanda Mama, you know, and there, it comes in many languages. And there is one, you know, there are many short stories, poems, little coloring, etc. But then the main, there is one, what is that, continuous feature. A constant feature is Vikram and this ghost, Vetala. And this Vetala means this ghost. This ghost that is sitting on the tree, and King Vikram has to take it and release it. But then he has to be in Maunam, because if you engage with this ghost, finished. You know, it gives you the slip when you're not looking. And so he tries to keep quiet, but then the ghost will pose a question, and he says, if you don't know the answer, your head will split into 1,000 pieces. So then he is forced to answer. King Vikram is forced to answer. The ghost gives him the slip. Until when? Next month, issue comes with a new story of the ghost. And the ghost itself narrates the story. At the end of the story, asks a question. Very entertaining. Yeah. Okay. All the best. Om Namah Shivaya.